Alrighty, so we're still doing remote recordings through the internet. I'm going to try not to talk too loud because it's only 9 p.m. where I am in Japan, but I know the people that own this building are right under me, and I don't know, I can't tell. I don't really hear other people, but I mean, I think Japan, pretty thin walls, so I might not talk too loud today just in case, but at least I'm not stuck in a musty closet in Montreal anymore. This is a definite upgrade. So, last episode, we watched that Lee Marvin show, M Squad. And how did we get to that? Oh yeah, and that was because the Police Squad show basically just took M Squad and added jokes. So we're going down this not completely sensical route of connecting these shows together, because at least those two, I guess, they're basically connected. But we never did find out what M Squad means. Potentially Murder Squad, but they never really say. And the only guess is, you mentioned, like, I don't know, it's like, it's not the Mod Squad though, right? It's a different show. And I was like, yeah, no, it's before the Mod Squad. So now that's why we're going to watch the Mod Squad, purely just because it sounds like M Squad. There's no other connection whatsoever. But I think this will be kind of interesting because I've heard of the Mod Squad, but I have never seen the Mod Squad. What are your experiences with the Mod Squad?
I don't remember any of the plot lines of the Mod Squad. All I remember is fashion. Bell-bottom pants, big hair, big afros. You know, if you really want to get a picture of 70s fashion, Mod Squad does it all.
Right.
It's supposed to be a police show, though. But they're mod. They're mod. They're modern.
Yeah, because even that, I mean, the bit that I know about mod is British stuff, not American. I didn't even realize there was like a mod movement in America.
There wasn't. It's a copycat. It's a fully copycat thing from the British mod, again, fashion era of the 1960s in Britain. Well, they've obviously just named a show Mod Squad to tie into that, and they are very fashion conscious. But there definitely was no mod movement in the United States. They were just copycats.
Right.
There's my take.
Yeah, because even the British one, it's not like I actually know anything about it. I just know, like, you know, people on scooters wearing Union Jack, you know, vests. I don't know.
Yes, and little leather coats and little leather caps similar to what you're wearing there, but with a little bit of a poof on the top. Carnaby Street, Mary Quant, Twiggy. That was all the mod era of fashion. And it would have been late 1960s in Britain. And men wearing Nehru shirts and striped suits with the big ruffles in the front, similar to 1800s type fare that men would have worn. But yeah, that was the whole mod fashion thing. Very, very distinctive. But I think Mod Squad, they just took the name and decided that they'd throw some fashion in too.
But I got some info about the Mod Squad, so let me lay it on you. The Mod Squad is an American crime drama series broadcast for 5 seasons, 124 episodes from 1968 to 1973. I thought it was interesting that one of the executive producers is Aaron Spelling, because he was around for decades, obviously, but...
Oh, yes.
I know him in my generation from Beverly Hills 90210 and Melrose Place, among many other things. He was involved in the Mod Squad. The Counterculture Police series earned 6 Emmy Award nominations, 4 Golden Globe nominations with 1 win, 1 Directors Guild of America Award, and so a lot of awards. You know, obviously this show seems like it was pretty well regarded, and it won 4 Logies. Have you ever heard of a Logie Award?
A Logie? Can't say I have.
No, nor had I, so I clicked on it, and basically... So our Canadian equivalent, we have a thing called the Juno, but nobody except a Canadian knows what that is. And even in Canada, nobody cares if you won a Juno. I think that's what happened. It would be like if some Canadian went on Wikipedia and started adding in all the awards, the regional awards no one cares about, because Logies are an Australian award. So no offense, Australia, but nobody cares if a show won 4 Logies. Some Australian guy definitely added that to the Wikipedia page. And again, you know, I know how it feels. Like I said, we got the Juno. Nobody cares about the Juno. Nobody cares about the Logie.
Well, now I don't feel so bad about not knowing about a Logie Award now that it's Australian. Of course I wouldn't know about it. They probably don't know about Junos.
Yeah, it'd be weirder if we did know what kind of, like, Australian super fan we have to be to know about that. So the concept of the Mod Squad was to take three rebellious, disaffected young social outcasts and convince them to work as unarmed undercover detectives as an alternative to being incarcerated. Their youthful hippie personas would enable them to get close to the criminals they would investigate. The times are changing, Captain Greer explained. They can get into places the regular police can't. And this was more than a year before the release of the film Easy Rider. The Mod Squad was one of the earliest attempts to deal with the idea of the counterculture. And I mean, it is a pretty good premise because that is true. I'm sure it's still true today. Like, if you want to go infiltrate some gang in Compton, you can't be Officer O'Reilly. It's not going to work. You know, you got to find some people that actually know what the hell's going on. So that seems kind of cool. And Aaron Spelling said, like, he just certain things, like, he didn't want to show arrests. He didn't want there to be guns. So just, you know, basic police show stuff that he's like, not for this show. And it is just funny how networks, when they're just behind the times, because this was on ABC, there was an episode where the black dude, who I don't know any of the characters' names yet, but, you know, it was like the white chick was supposed to kiss the black dude. And the network was like, it wasn't unheard of. Like, I think it was Star Trek, right, that did the first interracial kiss?
Star Trek and Lieutenant O'Hara and Captain Kirk, who they had a little bit of a snog.
Oh, yeah, of course it was Kirk. I should have known. So that had already happened, but ABC was still like, oh, you got to take that out. And Aaron Spelling argued with them, and they let him keep it in, but they were like, all right, you can keep it in, but you're going to get mountains of mail. Because I'm sure Star Trek did, but already at this point, by whenever that was, you know, late 60s, early 70s, he said he didn't get any mail about it. Just people didn't care. It's not a big deal. And it's just amazing how fast culture can change, A, but B, the network doesn't know that it changed. They're like, you can't do that. It's going to be a disaster. And nobody cared. And that's still, what a bizarre, I mean, I know Canada is just America, Junior, but what a weird country. Like, what a strange, fractured society that by the late 60s, it mattered that a black guy's getting a kiss on TV? What the hell? Like, what? That was not that long ago. Like, what a weird country.
But you have to remember that it was only 4 years before that. I think, no, longer than that. 63, 62? It was before Kennedy was shot. That the bus riots, all that through the South, had been going down, and the Freedom Riders getting the piss beaten right out of them because they were white people traveling on buses with black people trying to promote equality. So that was only a few years before. And I do remember all the talk about when Star Trek pulled that little scene. It was like, oh my. But you know what? I don't know. Maybe it wasn't people, audience, that was making the big deal. It probably wasn't. It was probably a bunch of those people running the show. They were the ones making the big deal about it.
And I mean, in virtually every one of these cases, from the dawn of modern media to now, it is also just these, you know, principally religious groups, but parent groups, various types of groups like that, that way outweigh everyone else, you know? Like, I remember when wrestling was big in the late 90s, there was basically just one company called the Parent Television Council that were the only ones who cared, but they sent, you know, literally thousands of letters to advertisers saying, you can't advertise on wrestling, it's too violent for kids, you know, like, just, so, I mean, these people are motivated, and it makes it seem like that things are bad.
Well, and what they don't get is if you don't make a big deal about certain things, then they're not big deals. But if you do make a big deal about them, really, you're enhancing or promoting that thing that is the issue. You're drawing it to people's attention who normally it wouldn't matter one way or the other. So a black guy kisses a white girl, whoopee ding. But if you start making a real big deal about it, you actually make it worse because you're drawing attention to something that shouldn't be a big deal anyway.
It's funny, too, just how maybe hypocritical is the wrong word, but how just like any of these situations that they're so easy to boil down as nonsense, like just in the example of wrestling being too violent. Somebody took, okay, here's an episode of Monday Night Raw. And yeah, okay, sure, it's a little violent. People are jumping off ladders and, you know, clotheslining each other, whatever. But then they compared it to, do you remember that movie Home Alone, where Macaulay Culkin got left home alone and these two robbers try to break into the house? And the stuff that kid did to those robbers in that kid's movie that John Hughes directed, they would be dead. It was so much worse than anything that has ever happened in wrestling. He's like putting paint cans on you know, ropes and swinging them full force in these poor people's faces. And just like you're dead. You just fractured your skull. So, but that's fine because that's a John Hughes movie. But wrestling, I don't know. It's like, it's always so dumb. It's always just the dumbest.
But just going back to your wrestling analogy, Okay, so there's a certain amount of violence on there. So you don't want children watching your violence. So let's talk about it and make a big deal about it and have it broadcast all over the place. What do you think your kids are going to do who may never have had an interest in wrestling before? Well, they sure do now. And they're going to go check it all out.
Before we watch, I just got the first episode of the Mod Squad. But there's also, before we watch that, I found a quick Simpsons clip, because there's always a Simpsons clip for something. This isn't directly about the Mod Squad, but this is so perfect, where it's a scene from when Homer was just a little wee baby, and it's about what happened to his mom. Why is his mom not around? And it's because she became like a counterculture terrorist almost, you know? She's like on the run from the law for all of her crazy stuff. But this little clip is just the difference between her and Homer's dad, where Homer's dad is, he's M Squad, he's Lee Marvin, he's like no nonsense. And Homer's mom is like, whoa, hippie time. Anyone at home who wants to watch this clip, it's just on YouTube, The Simpsons. Just search The Simpsons Sideburns and it'll come up.
The foppish follicles pioneered by Ambrose Burnside Appomattox, 1865.
Wild, untamed facial hair revealed a new world of rebellion, of change. A world where doors were open for women like me. But Abe was stuck in his button-down, plastic, fantastic Madison Avenue scene.
Look at them sideburns! He looks like a girl! Now, Johnny Unitas, there's a haircut you could set your watch to!
So I just feel like that, that seems appropriate. Especially if we compare M Squad to Mod Squad, of like the difference between the two approaches, the cool hip cops and, clearly Lee Marvin, he was not, he was a no-nonsense cop. He was very happy to shoot you.
Gee, I almost want to watch the rest of that. It's pretty good.
That's a good episode. Hey, we could throw that in. Maybe next week we'll do that one of just, the story of Homer's mom. It's actually a pretty good episode. But I was thinking what's funny about that too is how last week I was saying how I know Lee Marvin because of The Simpsons. Same exact thing with Johnny Unitas. He is a real man. He's an actual football player. But to me, he's a Simpsons character. He's shown up a few times. And so, yeah, we're just watching season one, episode one of The Mod Squad, which is called The Teeth of the Barracuda. I guess what I found surprising about that I kind of maybe misunderstood a little, just because we're talking about, mods and counterculture, and it's like, yay, fun fashions and the younger generation and, the long sideburns, forget them, Johnny Unitas haircuts. I thought maybe it was going to be more of a Charlie's Angels kind of, lighthearted show. But that show was serious as heck. It was too serious.
Well, I guess the counterculture had a serious side, and they were trying to show the standard conservative way life had been versus this sort of new hip way of looking at the world. It wasn't all fun and jokes.
Yeah, maybe serious is the wrong term. Maybe more just it's more realistic than I expected. It's not like a Charlie's Angels sort of flippant thing. It does seem like it's trying to present a more or less serious take on the police department, but just with these sort of undercover people that are not quite properly trained or what have you, that don't quite fit in. But I didn't know that's what it was going to be. It reminds me of, those like Marvel comics, Marvel movies. The different Marvel movies have different flavors to them. So, you know, some of them are sillier than others. So there's this one called The Winter Soldier. It's this Captain America movie that it's really famous. People really like it, but it's a dead serious spy thriller. And I'm not here to watch a spy thriller. I'm here to watch a superhero movie. Like, I never liked that one because it's so serious. And I mean, I want my superheroes to like tell a joke, you know? And I kind of feel like that with the Mod Squad. Like, I don't think there was a single lighthearted moment in that whole freaking episode. And I just didn't expect it to be like that.
I think it lived up to what I thought it might be. As I say, I don't really remember the shows. I just remember kind of when I watched it like 50-some years ago, the fashion and everything that was kind of cool in it. The shows themselves, not remarkable. I mean, there were any number of those things out at the time of those police-style shows. As far as plot and characterization and all that kind of stuff was involved, really, it was not remarkable in that sense. And as we both commented, the white actor, male, seemed a little old for, if he's supposed to be young people being able to fit in with that counterculture of drugs and hippiedom and all that, he seems a little on the long in the tooth.
Yeah, he was quite strange. The other two fit way better, and I guess that's the one scene that was funny, but it wasn't supposed to be. The super tone deaf scene where because he's the guy who comes from kind of a rich family, and he's in the car just like, yeah man, it's not as easy as you think it is. Oh, so I grew up with 15 different bathrooms in my mansion, and you know, they still kick me out, man. It's not easy. Meanwhile, he's next to a chick and a black guy, and they're both just like, shut up. I mean, they weren't. They were taking it serious, but they should have been like, honky, you need to shut the fuck up. You don't know what you're talking about.
You don't know what hardship is.
So that's kind of funny. Yeah, he just felt weird. He felt out of place. He seemed not only too old, but yeah, he was about as cool as like Frankie from Frankie and Annette. You know, he did not seem extremely hip to me.
The one fault that I would have, I mean, it held up well. It had beautiful scenery, as I said. My God, we saw beautiful scenes of the California coast, the ocean, and little cabins or summer houses they'd be along the shore. Beautiful. But they made such a point of having the guy who was picking up the garbage on the beach, like that older man who had the pole with the spike in it. They made such a point of him picking up that envelope with the negatives in it and throwing away the piece that he already had on the end of his spike, that it made you think, oh, is he working for the cops? Is he working for the bad guys? But it never went anywhere. Those negatives just disappeared. We never saw him again. And I was waiting, saying, well, how the heck did he fit in here? Well, I guess he didn't.
Yeah, and it could be. I didn't realize this at the time, but I was just doing a quick little, as we were watching, I did a quick little glance at the episode listing on the wiki page. And yeah, I guess that first episode, it was intended to be like a full TV movie that should have been 90 minutes. But they decided there was no need. Like, they went straight to it being a series. So they edited the 90 minutes down to 60 and just made it the first episode. So yeah, there's a random 25 to 30 minutes of stuff that they just cut out. Lord knows what it was, but maybe that's why. Maybe there's stuff like that.
And maybe that, and possibly that was part of it. Because at the very end, when they were standing on the dock and they were all, you know, kind of feeling sorry for themselves, I expected at that point, because we had never seen that man again with the PV pole, I expected at that point that they would have seen him and said, oh, wait a minute, that was the guy on the beach that day. And then they would have retrieved the negatives. But they didn't. It just never, nothing happened. He just kind of disappeared from the face of the earth, and that was the end of it.
Yeah, that's funny, too, that they potentially, I mean, we don't know for sure, but maybe they edited out important plot developments, but they're like, man, leave in, though, that part where he's like, Father, you think you have it so hard? Father, it only gives me $1,200 a week.
Stipend, you know? But what they're probably, they probably felt they had to leave that in because they were setting us up for future shows. So that was a little bit about a background of the characters. So to have that in future shows, they could build on that because they'd already introduced it. That's probably the reason they left that. But when you're just watching the one show, you're saying, oh man, you could have cut that out.
I think too, another reason maybe why the tone of it surprised me, the seriousness of it, is I'm just looking at Aaron Spelling's Wikipedia entry because, you know, like I was saying, I knew Beverly Hills 90210 and Melrose Place that were dramatic, but, you know, in a very dumb way. But he actually was involved in Charlie's Angels and The Love Boat. And there was a later series called Charmed that was about these, like, three witches. It was a bit like Buffy. So, yeah, it's like, I think he's kind of known for lighter fare. So I think that also maybe threw me off a little bit. Because, this show very much felt like, it didn't feel like, like I guess if we were comparing it to M Squad, say, it just felt like M Squad, but people wearing cooler clothes.
Yes, exactly.
The actual nuts and bolts of the police part of it was still just a very serious police show.
I was thinking of Canon. The show we saw on Canon when I was watching this was very similar in the seriousness of the issue they were trying to resolve. I found that's the one that came to mind for me, which would have been right in that time frame.
Yeah, so I guess that's like I'm surprised, I guess. That's like a weird irony I feel like I would prefer to watch Canon or M Squad. I feel like if you're going to be a very straight-laced, rod up your back, stiff cop show, then be that. You know, wear the suit. Have a gun. I don't know. Yeah, the inclusion of mod characters, it just didn't really do much for me. It felt like it was a little bit weird. But again, I mean, like they were saying, this is a transition period. Like Easy Rider hadn't even come out yet. This was like a pretty brand new idea. So I guess they were tiptoeing toward it. They didn't want to get too crazy because then maybe nobody would watch it back then. So yeah, I mean, certainly not a bad show, but that's not one that I would rush out to watch more episodes of myself.
Yeah, me either.
Cool. And yeah, now since it really is wild that just due to being from East Coast Canada and then going to Japan, that it's exactly a 12-hour difference. Like, that's so weird. It couldn't possibly be worse. So yeah, I got to hit the hay. I'm feeling kind of dopey right now.
It's hard to believe you're halfway around the world, though.
Yeah, it is kind of nuts. So yeah, tune in next time when hopefully I'm more acclimated and my brain is all the way back on.